Watching online. Let's stand as we sing our first song this morning.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles.
And those of you online, I suppose you can remain seated. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. It is good to be among God's people, where we can worship together and fellowship with one another. If you would like to join us here in the sanctuary, please contact Patty Shaw, and she may be able to find a spot for you. Today we have D.K. Hale coming to us from the metropolis of Cochrane. And he's a man who gets around, though. He was just telling me this morning how he was preaching in Fairview last month. Fairview, Alberta. That's north of Grand Prairie. So I'm sure his truck has a lot of miles on it. And we are very pleased to have him here with us today. There aren't too many announcements, so I'm not going to invent any There is no transition team meeting today. But remember, next week is Mother's Day. So I say that to all the children for your health. And of course, we love our mothers and we'll absolutely be praying for them. And so we should be doing something good for them. I'm going to read scripture today. It's taken from Colossians, Paul's letter to the church in Colossae, and from verses 3 to 14. In it, he gives this prayer for this local church where he's never been to before. But it's interesting what he prays for, and for them in particular. So as I read, you pay attention and follow along. Colossians chapter 1, I'll start to read at verse 3. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. Of this you have heard before in the word of the truth, the gospel, which has come to you, as indeed the whole world, it is bearing fruit and increasing, as it also does among you, since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God in truth, just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf and has made known to us your love in the Spirit. And so, from the day we heard, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of His will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to Him, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to His glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. He has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of His beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. That's the prayer Paul kept praying for the church in Colossae. Let's have a time of prayer for our own church. I will read from the names from our monthly prayer calendar. It was in the, just so you know, I do have a cheat sheet when I pray for names. I know these folks, but my memory isn't as good in terms of lists. But let's have a time of prayer, dedicating our time this morning to God, dedicating each other to Him, praying in the same way that Paul prayed for Colossae. Let's bow our heads. Father, we do dedicate our time today to You. We are so grateful that we can come and fellowship around the sung word and the spoken word, that we can do a little bit of visiting outside as well. Father, I thank You for our governments that allow us to meet in this way. There are many in our land who cannot, and we grieve with them. But we do rejoice that we can still meet, albeit in smaller numbers. Father, there are many of our people who are not well, who need employment, who have various financial issues going on in their lives, or simply life changes. Not bad, but significant. And Lord, I pray that You would be the God of all comfort where comfort is necessary. that you would be the God of all supply, where supply is needed. That you would be the great physician where someone needs health. Lord, I don't know everyone's situation. I don't know everyone's needs. But we can pray as the apostle prayed, that they would know you in the fullness of the revealed truth, your word. That they would make choices that please you in all of their living. Keep them close to you, Lord. We think particularly of Patty. Thank you for her service to this church, to make sure that we don't overcrowd ourselves and have to turn people away at the door every Sunday morning. Lord, I thank you for Brett. Although he's unable to be with us today, Lord, I pray for him. I pray for someone he was close to at work who is now hospitalized with COVID. We pray for Igor. Lord, I remember Logan and Candy and Logan Jr. and Liam. We think of Richard and Rowena, Dean, Matthew and Gabby. Lord, we remember Layton. We think also of Chris and Mia. Lord, we remember Brett's dad, Al. He's in need of some health troubles that he's had lately. And Lord, I pray that you would give him the stamina to come back from the difficult times he's had recently. But keep him healthy, Lord. Lord, I thank you for those who each week are putting hands to dials and microphones and keyboards to make sure that the word, your word, that is sung and proclaimed from this place can be shared with those at home and can be heard here in the auditorium. Thank you for all that dedicated AV team we have. Father, I could go on. We know we need you. We need you desperately every day of our lives. And for those of us, Lord, who think we don't, I'm sure, Lord, you can show them just how much you are needed. We pray especially this morning for DK and pray that you would, that your word would be spoken powerfully through him as he expounds it to us this morning. I thank you for John and Letitia leading us in music. And I thank you, Lord, for you. We meet on this day in remembrance of the day that you rose from the dead. We celebrate your resurrection every week. Hallelujah. Without that, our lives become meaningless real quick. But because you conquered death in the grave and you promised in your resurrection to be the first of that which follows and promise us the hope of resurrection in you as well. Oh Lord, you have wonderful things in store for us who believe. I thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand as we sing our next couple songs.
Christ alone. hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground. Fear through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace. When fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all. Here in the love of Christ I stand. Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay. Light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day. Up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns and calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb, Worthy is the Lamb. Amen. Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Amen.
You may be seated. All right, well, come on up, DK.
Moment of refreshing. Thank you for leading us in worship music today. Thank you very much. And Grandpa seemed to enjoy the few moments too that he had. So I think it's been about 4 months since I've been with you, and been lots of things happening. But boy, these last 14 months or so have been, they've been a challenge, haven't they? And it's not over yet, and we don't know when it will be over, when it will change, but we'll continue to press on. I have some prayer requests that I would share with you, and to those of you who are online today, we also are very grateful to have you here to worship with us. And we pray that you will sense the presence of the Lord in the same way as if you were here with us today, because we certainly value having you here online with us today. Just yesterday morning, I had my oldest brother who suffered a heart attack. They took him from Fairview to Grand Prairie last night. We'll fly him to Edmonton tomorrow for a stent. So you might want to pray for Jerry, is his name, and I would be grateful for that. Brenda and I were up north, as Paul mentioned earlier, to one of our churches in Fairview. On Easter Sunday, and we were in contact with a positive, so we came back and had our test, and the very night that Brenda got her test during the day, by 2 o'clock the next morning, we get the text that, you know, from AHS that she's negative, and I didn't get mine for a couple more days, and then it said that I was inconclusive, which means you go back and have another test. So I booked the one in Cochrane as soon as I could, and the day that I, after I had gone in and had that test, I came back to look at the mail, and it said that you are now positive. And so then in a few minutes, probably an hour, I get a phone call to say we just want to confirm that you are positive. And I said, so, you know, I was inconclusive when this day started, They said, but you're positive now. And I said, is that based on the test that I had yesterday? And the person said, well, what test are you referring to? And I said, I had another test yesterday. Oh, no, we're still talking about the test that you had a week ago. And I said, so with the stroke of the pen, you've moved me from the inconclusive column to the positive column. And so this person said, well, if you were tested again yesterday, we haven't heard from that, so let's just say that you're still inconclusive. And so then in just a little while, I get another one of the printouts that by name, you are negative. So then before that day was over, I got a phone call from AHS and said, we want to confirm that you are negative. So I said, this has been a very interesting, challenging day. I've gone from inconclusive to positive to inconclusive to negative, and then another negative that night. And then 2 days later, the doctor sent negative. So I believe I'm negative today. And it's been a challenge. My heart goes out to those people who are working in Alberta Health Services, because those decisions that are coming to us, they're not the decision of the people who swabbed you or did some blood, some test. So we need to be as nice to them as we possibly can. Hurting also. So we'll be lifting them up. Today I want to preach a message that will address you or like several other churches in Alberta right now. And it's got to be hard without a pastor, because we've got churches that are really, really struggling who have a pastor. They have all of their staff, and yet it's hard. So I'm praying for you. I want you to know that Brenda and I pray for you, that God will give to you the right pastor at his time. And I'm also praying with you that his time will be quicker than you thought. So we'll just pray to that end. So let me lift up in prayer today, and then I want to preach a message that I believe would be good preparation for this church as you anticipate and wait before the Lord, anticipating a pastor. Father, we bow before you this morning, and oh, how grateful we are to have a God who knows and understands, and you care, you're capable. And God, we're not going to bring any information this morning. We're just going to simply talk to you as a group of people who kneel and close our eyes and bow our heads, asking you to speak to us today. Father, thank you for the ones that are online, the ones that are in the room. We ask that you would lift the burdens, that you would address the needs of each one that's here. Father, there are those who are out of work. There are small businesses that have had to close their doors. And God, there are so many sick people, and they can't even have proper family visitations. And Lord, I've got friends that have had loved ones who've passed on. They cannot have the proper memorial service. And Lord, for those 8 dear cancer friends that I'm praying for and trying to encourage at arm's length, God, we just recognize today that we need Jesus Christ to speak in a new and a fresh way through the power of the Holy Spirit. Encourage each one who will be listening today. Get glory for yourself. That would be our prayer. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. I made a decision several years ago, and some of you may have heard me say this before. I think now it would probably be maybe 15 years ago, probably even approaching 20, that I woke up and I began to realize, Lord, I don't want to have to work with religious people the rest of my life, because religious people can really get on your nerves. I began to pray this scripture that we're going to read right here, what it says in Matthew chapter 9, verse 36 through 38 in the New American Standard Version. It says, seeing the people, he felt compassion for them because they were distressed and dispirited like sheep without a shepherd. And then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Therefore, beseech the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest. So I began to pray, Lord God, if you're going to handpick some people and you're going to prepare them and you're going to send them forth into your harvest, I want you to help me know when I run across one of them, because that's who I want to work with. Those that know that God has touched their life, they know God has called them into kingdom service, they have a desire to be obedient, to follow him to the very best of their ability. So as I began to pray that, God began to give me some scripture to help me know how to identify those kind of people. And this would be what I would be praying for Trinity, as well as all of our other pastorless churches. I would be praying that God would help you prepare for your next pastor. You know, we always want to know, well, tell me a lot about the pastor. I have this question, those. But, you know, a pastor has a right to have questions about us too, doesn't he? You know, we need to be the kind of church that would be a delight to pastor, would be an honor to go pastor that church. And so that's what I want to ask us today, is that would we let God prepare our hearts and our minds? The very first one would be in Luke chapter 22 and verse 42. And that's where we would ask God to give us people and churches who are surrendered to the will of God. Father, if it's your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Now, what if every person who's a part of Trinity Baptist Church would pray that very same prayer? God, not my will, but thine be done. That means that your new pastor would have no personal agenda. The elders would have no personal agendas. The leadership team would have no personal agenda, because we're all praying the very same agenda. We're praying that God, your will would be done here. And you know, if a church begins to do that, there will be no more church arguments and there will be no more church splits. Wouldn't that be a blessing to be, you know, where we come to a business meeting or a family meeting or whatever, a fireside chat, whatever you want to call it, where when you walked in there, everybody that came in that room had been praying, God, not my will, but thine be done. So we only have one agenda to deal with. When I became the pastor, the interim pastor at Bow Valley several years ago, about 12 or 13 now, between two of the pastors, boy, that was one of the hardest ministry times I've had in a long time. I had people tell me that you worked your way in to getting some of the leaders moved out so you could come in and bring your ministry. And boy, I tell you, it was hard, because they said, you have your own agenda. So I finally preached a message entitled, Yes, I Have an Agenda. And my agenda is to get everybody on the same agenda. You know, instead of having all these different splintered ideas, we need to come in together in this room. And those that are online, if you're a part of this church, or if God should lead you to be a part of this church, we want God's will to be done. Acts chapter 2 and verse 1 says, they were one accord in one place. That's I love that verse, because it's very possible for us to be, that really means they were together. We can be together in this room physically, but we can be a long ways apart in what we're thinking, what we're desiring. But if we're praying for one common agenda, then this verse becomes reality. We are together, physically, emotionally, mentally, spiritually. We're on one path together. And then the second one would be, we're asking God for people in churches who will do everything they can do with, through, or for Jesus Christ. Everything that they can do with, through, or for Jesus. In Mark chapter 14, verse 3 through 9, and I'll probably not read all that because of time, but if you'll just look down through that, the story is while they were reclining at the table, this lady comes in with the expensive box of perfume, breaks it open, pours it on Jesus Christ. Notice in verse 5 it says, they were after her, indignantly after her. This could have been sold for more than a year's wages, and the money given to the poor. I've always said at that point, I would love to have been there, because I think when that happened, I think Jesus would begin to say, well, we'll be meeting here next Sunday. Why don't you bring your bank stubs and your receipts with you and see how much you've given to these poor people that you're worrying about? I pastored a church one time that one of the leaders said, we don't like to pass the offering plate and receive tithes and offerings because if someone can't give, then they're going to be on a guilt trip. You know, the only people that should be on a guilt trip are those that could and didn't. Those that should and didn't. God knows who cannot give any kind of money today, but he also knows that we need to do what we can do. So going on through in verse 6, Jesus said, leave her alone. Why are you bothering her? She's done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you'll always have with you, and you could help them anytime you want, but you'll not always have me. Look at verse 8. She did what she could. That's what makes up a wonderful church. If in Trinity Baptist Church, every member, every person who's a part of this congregation of believers would say before God, as I prayed, God, not my will, thine be done, I will do everything I can do. Boy, that would be a wonderful place, Pastor, where every person help me know what I can do. So that means that you could go to the pastor, you could go to the elders, you could go to whoever who's the chairman of your leadership team, and you could just simply say, I can't sing, and I can't preach, and I've never tried to, but I'm here to do everything I can do. Boy, there are lots of things around in the life of a church, not just the building, in the life of the church family that need people to plug those little leaks, plug those little gaps, and do what we can do. She had poured a perfume on my body and behold, beforehand to prepare for my burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. So what's going to be told? The fact that she did what she could do. It's not about the detail of what they did as much as they did what they could do. I would ask myself through my life and even at this point, am I doing what I can do? Paul mentioned a while ago, last Sunday I preached at Bow Valley because they're still without a pastor. They've called a pastor and he will be there June 27th. But as I was preaching there and I finished and then I got word that afternoon that you need to be on alert. You may need to preach for the Cowboy Church Tuesday night because now that pastor is in the hospital and they're not exactly sure what all's wrong. They do know his sugar was out of whack and other things. But so then Tuesday, I got word Monday and said, you will preach Tuesday night. Tuesday morning, I get the word that would you also do 7 2-minute devotions to record that night right before you preach on Tuesday to play for the rest of the week. So that's what happened. Then on the Cowboy Trail Church, you preach Tuesday night. They catch the 7 devotionals. And then I knew I was going to get to come here today. So the question is, am I doing what I can do? I'm doing the best I can do. I believe that at this point, I'm probably running pretty close to what I can do at 74 years old. God is so good, isn't he? Britt and I, in one of our devotions this morning, were reading that sometimes we feel like, you know, we're overloaded or maybe we're not loaded enough. But I think God will give you what you're willing to do, and he will honor it, and he will bless it. The third one comes out of Mark chapter 12, verse 41 to 44. And this is people at churches who will, because of Jesus, give their best. Now, that is not just talking about the best of your money. That's going to be an example here. But that's not all that's involved in serving the Lord and giving your best. He says there, Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. I can remember when I was younger, that verse almost scared me. It almost haunted me. You mean Jesus Christ is watching and monitoring what I'm giving to his kingdom work? And I think you've heard me say lots of times, You don't give to Trinity. You give to the Lord Jesus Christ through the ministries of Trinity Baptist Church. Many rich people threw in large amounts, but a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins worth only a few cents. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on." Now, really what that is, it's not as much an emphasis on how much or whatever, but it's a statement to say, here is a widow that literally trusted God for everything, even for her livelihood today, tomorrow. We have lots of widows in our life, in our ministry, in our friends along the years. And boy, I want to tell you, for a lot of these widows right now, it is tough. It is just simply really tough. They don't have their maid anymore. They don't have the income that came from his pensions or his CPP and those kind of things. Yet here's a widow that said she gave everything she could. And I think, again, that's in life. When you're serving God, would you give him your best? You don't give him the dregs of your life at the end of the day. Give him the best. The best. Boy, there are some sharp minds in the world right now. You know, they're not all acting the way a lot of people are acting in the world. There are some good minds that are applying themselves the very best that they know how to move us forward, move us out of the mess we're in, just to move society forward, move the church forward, move the family forward, move the community forward. And so that, I think, is what we're talking about here. Give the best you could. If you were to ask yourself right now, this last week, did I give God the best I could? Or did I just, you know, give him something? But or did I give him the best? Let's just say hypothetically that Diane knew that I love these 6 or 7 layer chocolate cakes. They used to have those when I was going to school in Pasadena, Alabama. You know, they have a little thin chocolate cake like this and almost that much icing. And then another layer of cake, another icing. And it was 6 or 7 layers. And Diane knew, and you could agree, that I'd like those. She brings one and says to me this morning, "DK, I brought you one of those chocolate cakes that you like." Well, then after the service, Diane came to me. She said, "DK, we've just received a word, and the elders, a couple of the elders are going to have to go to a home where there's a crisis right now. And they would like to take some. What about that cake? Could I have some of that cake back that I gave you before church?" You know what I would do? I would say, "Here's the cake. Do you want this much, or do you want it all?" You know why I'd be willing to do that? It wasn't mine to begin with. It was given to me. What I give back to the Lord Jesus Christ, it's not mine. It was just given to me to manage, to look after, and to give stewardship back to the good things of the Lord. So it's not just money and things. We give our personal best to the Lord Jesus Christ. The fourth one is, we're looking for people in churches who will trust the Lord Jesus for the unbelievable and the impossible. In Luke chapter 9, verse 12 through 17, late in the afternoon, the 12 came to him and said, "Send the crowd away so that they can go to the surrounding villages and countryside and find food and lodging, because we're in a remote place here. There are no fast food places to run to. We've got these 5,000 men, and we have nothing to feed them." Jesus told them, it seems, "Why don't you go out there in the crowd and look around and find all the people with a Trinity Baptist Church name tag on and see what they got that they could give?" They said, "We did." And they had a potluck dinner, and everything's gone. So now we have nothing to feed them. Notice what he began to say. "We only have five," they said, "we only have 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Unless we go and buy food for all this crowd," about 5,000 men were there. "But he said to his disciples, 'Have them sit down in groups of about 50 each.' The disciples did so, and everyone sat down, taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke them And then he gave them to the disciples to distribute to the people. They all ate and were satisfied. I like other translations, says they were all filled. And the disciples picked up 12 baskets of broken pieces that were left over. Let me ask you, when he said to take that and feed 5,000 men, I would say that was unbelievable and impossible. It could not be done unless something took place. What did take place? It said he looked up to heaven, gave thanks, and said, start feeding them. So put them in groups of 50 and start feeding them. And they fed them until they were all satisfied, or as other translations, they were all filled. And then they picked up the 12 baskets. So how many disciples did he have still at that time? 12. How many baskets? 12. What was the message here? I think the message was for the disciples and for us. They provided nothing for this dinner on the grounds. And yet they all ate until they were satisfied. And they picked up and had a basket each to take with them. That was not to watch the late movie or to have Monday's lunch ready to go. That was a message to say, as you leave here, on your way home, you're going to find some other people who are hungry. And you need to share your basket with other people who are hungry and in need. I tell you, we did not come to this church building today to be refreshed, uplifted, encouraged, and maybe filled up just to go out and try to endure another week and we'll come back next Sunday. We came here asking God to speak to our needs, to encourage and refresh us. But he wants us, when we leave here, to take something with us to those that you run into this coming week that you can share a good word to, you can share an encouragement to, you can try to lift them up. You've heard my illustration so many times. Every one of us in this room and every one of us online, we're either a fountain or we're a drain. The fountain means people love to see you coming because you lift them up, encourage them, you refresh them. And then there are those that walk by 20, 30 feet out there, and every time you see them, it's like they just suck the energy right out of you. They drain you. I'm asking God that he would help us to be one of those that would take from what we heard today from the Word of God, and we would use that to share with many other people. Do you personally have some unbelievable, impossible things ahead of you? As a church family, do you have some unbelievable, impossible things ahead of you? I would say yes, unless God intervenes. Look up, give thanks, and ask God to help you move on. And then the last one, we're looking for people in churches who are prepared, according to Galatians chapter 6, verse 17, to bear the brand marks of Jesus on their body. Galatians says, from now on, let no one cause trouble for me, for I bear on my body the brand marks of Jesus. Most of you realize I grew up on a farm and ranching background, and I know it's kind of brutal, but we always branded our calves in the spring for identity purposes, and because when we took them to the community pasture, like now, they may have 3,500 steers that they break up into some pastures there. And my dad back then, we all used a horse. Now some of them use quads or whatever. But you could go around and say, there's a couple of mine right over there. There's another one of mine right there. Oh, yeah, that's one of mine over there. How did you know that? Because they had his brand on them. I believe as Christians today, we need to make sure that we bear the brand marks of Jesus on our body. It cost him dearly, and his body bore witness to it when he gave his life that I might be called Christian. He had all kinds of marks on his body. Brenda and I, in the spring, when we sell an animal, you go out and look at them, and sometimes somebody else's cattle spend a winter with yours because you didn't get them all separated properly. And when you looked at it, and I would think, yeah, that calf has my brand on the side there, K-bar H on the left rib. So we'd catch it up, and we'd shave that right there where the brand was. And sure enough, there's my brand. I believe for Trinity to be ready for your new pastor, we need to make sure we all have a good spring haircut. Get rid of all the stuff that hinders people being able to see the brand of Jesus Christ. I simply mention these five brand marks. The brand mark of surrender in Luke chapter 22. The brand mark of compassion, Luke 19 and Luke 23. The brand mark of ridicule. The brand mark of sacrifice. We are to be living sacrifice, Romans 12, 1 and 2. And then the mark of dedication or commitment, where Jesus said, it's finished. And Paul said, I finished the race. I want to say, I finished strong. And how about you? Bear the brand marks of Jesus Christ. Father, as we come and sing our final worship song, Lord God, you've heard our heart today. You know the thoughts that are going through our mind and the feelings in our heart. God, help us to be the kind of people that you can use, the kind of church that you can use in this troubled world that we're in right now. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let's stand as we sing our final song.
To be in worship with you today. I hope you have a wonderful week. Those of you online, we again are very thankful that you chose to be with us today. It would be my prayer today that the Lord Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit, would lead you and guide you this coming week. Pray one prayer. Not my will, but thine be done, Lord. God bless you. You're dismissed.